I'd argue that the Kirby series has been pretty consistent throughout its life. The main series of games are typically 2D side-scrollers with pretty low difficulty. I personally don't find this to be a bad thing, as I think it's nice to have some chill games in the library. It's fun to play these intense games, sure, but it's also fun to have those shut-your-brain-off kind of games, and Kirby 64 The Crystal Shards is exactly that. Even though this is a Nintendo 64 game, it stays true to the franchise's roots and is a 2D platformer. I actually kind of prefer this, because with games like Banjo-Kazooie, Banjo-Tooie, Super Mario 64, and plenty of licensed titles like Toy Story 2, the Nintendo 64 had plenty of 3D platformers. The story itself is told through these cute little cutscenes. Basically, Kirby will need to help Ribbon collect pieces of crystal that were broken off an important artifact located on the Ripple Star. After defeating Waddle Dee, Adeline, and King Dedede, they will join Kirby on his quest. If the player beats Miracle Matter with all crystal shards, it will be revealed that a secret seventh planet is available. Here, Kirby will have a pretty neat showdown with O2, with a hidden power combo. After O2 is defeated, the game will show one last cutscene, and then the credits roll. The game is a 2.5D side-scroll that has the player take control of Kirby. Kirby can still swallow enemies and take their powers, but this time with a twist. Kirby 64 introduces power combos, which will allow Kirby to take one power and mix it with another. There are 7 core powers in the game. Those core powers are Burn, Stone, Ice, Needle, Bomb, Spark, and Cutter. A core power can be combined with itself, meaning that there are 28 power combos and 7 regular powers for a total of 35 abilities. I guess there's also one for the final boss only, so I guess we'll say 36. The stage has 6 main worlds, each with 3 or 4 levels each, as well as a boss fight. A secret 7th world can be unlocked, but it only contains a boss fight. Kirby has 6 health points, and they happen to run out, he will lose a life. If poor old Kirby loses all of his lives, the player will suffer a game over. Kirby can gain lives by picking up a 1-up or collecting enough stars. Kirby recruits 3 allies along the way, and they all help Kirby during his adventure. Waddle Dee will help Kirby out by opening certain sections of the map, providing Kirby with sleds, minecarts, and little boats to get through certain sections. In certain levels, Kirby will hitch a ride on King Dedede's back, at which point the player can control him. He can use his trusty hammer to remove larger obstacles. Adeline will help Kirby by solving certain puzzles to help him get crystal shards. She will also appear in certain levels to give Kirby a 1-up if he has full health, or a maximum tomato if he doesn't. Going back to Kirby's moveset, he can hold enemies above his head. Some will have a neat little effect, like a Terran will help him glide, while holding a Glunk above his head will make it chew pellets. He can also do a small kick by crouching and hitting A. In a very few levels of the game, the Invincible Candy also appears, which will make Kirby invulnerable for a short amount of time. I'll go over the double stack power combos real quick, because there are only 7 after all. The burn will have Kirby turn into a giant flame and rush forward. The double stone will simply make Kirby into a giant stone. The double ice will have Kirby turn into a giant snowball, demolishing nearly everything in its path. The double needle one is just bizarre. The different spikes are different objects, such as a bee stinger and a cactus. The double cutter is the same as a normal cutter, but the blade will be much larger. The double bomb one will have Kirby shoot 3 homing missiles out of his mouth. Lastly, the double spark one will have a huge area of electricity protecting Kirby. One thing that I think is interesting about these is the fact that some of them, like the double stone or cutter, are just better versions of their core power. Meanwhile, some of them, like double ice and double bomb ones, are actually completely different. My favorite thing about Kirby 64 is simply swallowing enemies, taking their powers, and seeing what Nintendo can come up with for the power combos. One of my favorite ones is Burn and Bomb, which will make Kirby shoot out fireworks. Cutter and Burn is another great one. It'll have Kirby take a fire sword out of his mouth, he can throw it at enemies or prepare a new one too. Cutter and Spark is another sword-like power-up, except it'll be dual-wield blade, which I think is just badass. Bomb and Cutter will give Kirby awesome ninja stars that will explode on contact. Needle and Cutter will turn Kirby into this giant-ass weird monster thing. Man, Cutter is just an amazing core ability. Let me gush about a couple of other of these before moving on. Like the Spark and Ice one. It turns Kirby into a refrigerator. This one is actually pretty awesome because Kirby can pick up the food to heal himself. The food can also be used to hurt enemies if they happen to walk into it. The Needle and Ice combo will turn Kirby into a giant snowflake. The Snow and Stone ones turn Kirby into a curling stone, which I find to be pretty funny. Another cool one is the Spark and Bomb one, which will turn Kirby into a light bulb that will explode. The Needle and Spark ability reminds me of Pikachu's Down Special in the Super Smash Bros. Series. Needle and Stone gives Kirby a big-ass drill. I can keep going on about these power combos. They're just such a neat idea, and I really wish something similar could come back to the franchise one day. I'll get a bit negative early on here. I absolutely love the idea of the power combos. However, the puzzles that involve them are quite weak. Most of the time, there will be a block that is one solid color, or multicolored if a power combo is needed. Like this one, for example, is a checkered orange and yellow block. To destroy it, Kirby will have to use the spark and needle combo to break it. Even something as simple as powering a generator to open a door would have been kind of cute and cool. It just makes it feel super arbitrary. Here's another one, except this time the player needs the ice and needle power combo to break this lava rock here. How the hell is one even supposed to gather that just from looking at it? In the very first stage, there is a crystal shard underneath a black block. The player, again, must simply just use a bomb power on it and it breaks. I like how in games like Kirby's Adventure, there would be stakes that Kirby can hammer down, ropes that can be covered with a sword, or cannon ropes that can be burned. It made it feel more, let's say, organic and natural. The game is also pretty damn short. The game is 6 main worlds long, and each of them can easily take an hour or even less. The Hidden 7 world is just a boss fight, though it is a sick one. Unlike, say, Pikmin or Luigi's Mansion, which are other notoriously short games, there really isn't too much of a reason to go back to Kirby 64. Even something as easy as the high score system that was in Kirby's Adventure is just straight up gone in Kirby 64. Come to think of it, the alternate endings to levels and other secrets are mostly gone too. The 3 shards that are found in each of the levels really aren't too difficult or time-consuming to seek out. Back in the day, this was a full-price release. As a result, it could have been very difficult to justify the purchase. For only 10 bucks in the Wii U shop, though, probably worth it for anyone looking for another Kirby game to play. I've been in it roughly 5 hours according to the Wii U game log, but I'd say it's probably closer to 4.5, taking a look at the actual gameplay clips that I have saved. I gotta get a few positives in there, though, as I enjoyed the game overall. I'll talk about the presentation first, because even though this is a Nintendo 64 game, I really don't think the graphics are too bad. This is most likely due to the art style, which is nice and simple. Kirby himself is kind of hard to screw up graphically. He's a pink puffball. Even though the game is a 2.5D side-scroller, it's still nice to see these 3D environments and enemies, which is a first for the franchise. Some levels, like the one with the waterfalls, or the nice-looking cloud or snow levels, just look so much better than they would have on older hardware. It's aged much more gracefully than a lot of other Nintendo 64 titles, that's for sure. Also on that topic, some of these enemies are just so adorable. Remember when I was picking on the power combo puzzles? Well, some of them are actually unique and interesting. My favorite one involves the cutter and stone ability. With this ability, Kirby can carve himself into various allies in past games, including Rick the Hamster. Rick the Hamster can wall jump, which is neat to get this crystal shard because Kirby can't fly infinitely in this game. Another neat one is using the spark and bomb power combo to light up this room so Kirby can see the markings on the wall. Even something as simple as using the fire and needle combo to hit this target on the ground, or using a burn power to melt this ice, feels so much more natural than just sticking like an arbitrary colored block and hiding a crystal shard inside. I signal out the fire and needle one specifically because this power combo is Kirby shooting a fire arrow. It kind of makes it feel more like target practice, or something along those lines. I'll go over the 6 worlds briefly. Up first is Planet Popstar. The first level has amazing music, but this is where the whole lack of impressions thing comes up. Like, it's fine for a first level of a game, but man, there is just not much to say here. The fight with Waddle Dee, or I guess Waddle Doo, the first time is fun though. A second level is at least a bit more interesting, as it has a nice autumn setting and a wonderful music track. Kirby will have to fight Adeline at the end of the level. She will attack Kirby by drawing paintings that come to life. The third level is Kirby exploring King Dedede's castle, with a boss fight against him at the end of the level. The boss of the planet is Wispy Woods. His first stage involves Kirby killing his offspring. Jeez, that's brutal. The second stage of the fight involves him spreading out his roots to try to hit Kirby. Once Kirby hits him a few times, the crystal shard will be given up. The second world is Planet Rockstar. The first level is really just a sand-themed level. It has a nice gimmick of the pyramid filling up with sand. When Kirby reaches the top, Waddle Dee breaks him out. The second level has ruins in the middle of an oasis. Not too much going on here, unfortunately. The third level is back to the same sand theme, except it's underground now. It also turns into a water level toward the end. Speaking of which, this is the only Kirby game where Kirby can suck up enemies underwater. He usually just spits out an attack bubble in other games. The fourth level involves Kirby climbing a giant spaceship. This is the level that has the spark and bomb puzzle that I described earlier. One of the more memorable levels for sure, especially since it comes out of a planet that has a sand theme, which I would not have expected. The boss of this planet is the Pyx. A blue, green, and red crystal will chase Kirby as the main platform rises. At the top, Kirby can hit them with standard abilities or suck up these atoms that they leave behind. If Kirby hits one of them with their own colored atom, it will take more damage. The third world is the Aqua Star. The first level is a nice tropical island area. There is a cave portion about halfway through. The second level is a forested area with river that flows throughout the entire stage. There's a fun Waddle Dee segment in the level where Kirby and Waddle Dee will ride in a boat. The third level has a beach theme and it's pretty cute. There are plenty of sand sculptures everywhere, as well as crab, fish, and other beach-like enemies. This level contains the Cutter Stone Power Combo Crystal Shard that I was on about earlier. The fourth level is the one where it's just completely underwater. Actually a unique one for the game, it's the only one to do that. There are plenty of annoying parts where the current is fighting the player. The boss fight for this planet is against Acro, an annoying killer whale. The fight takes place completely underwater. The first part of the boss is Kirby fighting it on the ocean floor, meanwhile the second phase has them both swim swimming upward. The Neo Star is a weird planet that is home to jungles, volcanoes, and deep caves all at the same time. The first level is a jungle that has pitfalls, tons of flying enemies, and plenty of logs that Kirby can jump on. Stage 2 takes place in a deep cave. This level contains a Wowzy segment where he and Kirby must ride a minecart. It's similar to the boat segment of the previous star. There is also an annoying crystal shard that requires Kirby to have the stone and bomb power up. He must enter the stage with it as it can't be obtained in the stage. And this move hurts Kirby if used incorrectly. Stage 3 is a mountainous stage with a dumb Adeline puzzle. I was supposed to make a pizza out of all these blocks. The fourth stage is a lava stage that forces the player to control King Dedede at a certain point. The boss fight against Magman takes place inside a volcano. The first portion of the fight has it shooting lava at Kirby, while all the while Kirby has only four little rocks to stand on. The second portion of the fight is on land. The fifth star is called the Shiver Star, and oddly, there's only one Snowy-themed stage, despite its name. The first stage is said Snowy-themed stage, and it's pretty cool, I guess. There's a bobsled section with Waddle Dee. The second stage is Kirby going to the sky. The stage has that annoying-ass spark and needle crystal shard. The third stage takes place inside a toy factory. It features a dumb puzzle with Adeline that I had to look up. How in the ever-loving name of shit was I supposed to know that first marking is a coconut? The fourth stage is Kirby running through another factory of sorts. There's a section where the player takes control of King Dedede. This has plenty of one-hit KO moments, such as getting swished by the rubber mallets or shifting ceilings. The boss of the stage is a robot called HR-H. What a dumb name. It uses its flippers to try to hurt Kirby, as well as its lasers. After enough hits, it will turn into a new form called HR-E. Still a dumb name. It will jump onto the track that Kirby is running on and shoot missiles at him. Kirby can hurt it by shooting its shadowy body. The final proper star is the Ripple Star, which is being taken over by darkness. The first level in this world looks very familiar. Oh yeah! The layout is identical to the very first level in the game. I think it's a cute idea, but likewise, with the first level, there isn't too much to say here. The second level is an eerie stage that has Kirby go through a castle. There's also an underwater segment with music that is just so dark. The third level in this star has Kirby battling waves of enemies in a gigantic castle. In fact, every single enemy that is not a boss appears in this level. At the end of the level, the player can see darkness at the top of the screen. Surely, something interesting must be coming up next. The sixth boss of the game is Miracle Matter, and it's a pretty interesting boss fight. It contains the ability to use all seven core abilities to try to hurt Kirby. Kirby can only hurt it back if he uses the ability that Miracle Matter is currently using. All of its attacks are fairly unique too. Like during the fire phase, it will move around and shoot fire horizontally, vertically, or both. The electric form is probably the toughest to take care of. Those electrical beeps can go anywhere, I swear. Kirby can swallow the abilities and use them against Miracle Matter if he pleases. Power combos will hurt both phases of the boss. For example, I had the cutter and the rock power combo for a portion of the fight. I used this attack on the rock form, and Miracle Matter received damage. If I would have used it on the spike portion, it would have received damage as well, but I chucked it by that point. As portions of Miracle Matter get destroyed, its red eyes will become solid black. The final secret world is only unlocked after Kirby beats the original final boss after all the crystal shards have been collected. The darkness escapes off the Ripple Star and becomes its own entity. Kirby has to complete a very small platforming section before he's given the Ribbon and Crystal Power combo. This will enable Kirby to shoot crystal shards out of the crystal gun, while having Ribbon fly him around. Together, Kirby and Ribbon will have to dodge O2's attacks and shoot his eye with the crystal shards. After shooting in the eye enough times, O2 will flip over to cover his poor eye. This will reveal a halo on top, which can be shot at. After it's shot enough times, O2 will flip over, revealing some weird green thorn thing underneath itself. Kirby can now drain its health bar by shooting at it. Its wings can also be shot during the fight to reduce its mobility. Once its health is gone, Kirby and the gang have won. That's about it for the main game, but Kirby 64 has some other things that may interest the player. Remember how I brought up that this game has cute cutscenes? Well, this can be viewed at the main menu, which is honestly great. The soundtrack can also be heard at the main menu, which is welcome because some of these tunes are serious bop. When Kirby completes a level, he can participate in a minigame where the player has to pick a direction and a range for Kirby to leap. The player should notice that there are cards on the picnic setup. If Kirby gets one of these, the player can go back to the main menu and take a look at the enemy cards. If Kirby gives a shocked look after picking one up, that means it's a duplicate. There is also a boss rush mode, and it is no joke. Basically, the player has to take on the seven bosses of the game without power-ups and in one life. This is where a difference between the Wii U Virtual Console and the Nintendo 64 version exists. In the original, Kirby can take powers during the fight with Miracle Matter. I would grab the spark and ice combo to turn into the fridge and heal up. On the Virtual Console version, Kirby can't keep the powers that he swallows during the Miracle Matter fight. I may have cheated a bit and used the Virtual Console save states, but they took away my fridge, dammit! When completed, the game will congratulate the player. And that is it! Nothing is gained when completing this. It's a fun little side thing to do if one is looking for more challenges out of the game. There are also three mini-games present: 100-yard hop, Bumper Crop Bump, and Checkerboard Chase. The first one involves a player hopping across a field. If the A button is pressed, then the player will advance two spaces, while hitting the B button will advance them only one space. There will be obstacles, like puddles and frogs that will slow down the player if stepped on. The second minigame involves the participants trying to catch as many fruits as they can from falling trees. The player can also hit the A button to swap places with the person next to them. These two are pretty fun, but Checkerboard Chase is by far my favorite one. When a player presses A, they will send a wave of energy forward that will make the blocks fall in front of them. This can get intense with other people, man. A neat thing about all these minigames is that there are four difficulties, which are easy, medium, hard, and intense. These will change the CPU's behavior, as well as the background and gameplay of the minigame. The four characters one can be are Kirby, Waddle Dee, King Dedede, and Adeline. People can be the same character if they want. Different color palettes of the characters exist for this reason. That is Kirby 64 The Crystal Shards. More or less. It's a game that is packed with charm, fun music, and cool power combos. The gameplay is nice and chill, but that can lead to it being a bit too easy at times. The minigames can provide at least some amount of fun if one has a few friends around. The game is a bit short though, and as a couple more stars would have really gone a long way. I still enjoyed my time with it, and realistically, it's still one of my favorite Kirby games. With a bit more content or a reason to replay it, I could justify a 6 out of 7 here. However, I just gave Luigi's Mansion a 6 out of 7 last week, and I don't think this quite matches that. I will give Kirby 64 a solid 5 out of 7. It was great fun when I played it.